Save me, Guru Raghavendra, save me. Like the surroundings that had been cooled by the downpour of the night, my mind was also free from anxieties, a kind of peace pervading me in the morning. From 8 a.m., the dining hall was seen to be in occupancy. The invitees swarming there in batches. In the mantapa, the religious part of the rituals was going on methodically. And Sri Ramakrishnachar, the chief priest, told me strictly that I should stay put at the dais itself till 11 a.m. I told him that after meeting the invitees at the dining hall and making enquiries about them, I shall be at the stage from 9 a.m. I then went to the dining hall and after extending due courtesies to the guests having their breakfast there, I looked into the office room and found that the manager was not present there. Of course, he had informed me that he would be coming to the marriage hall only in the afternoon. The marriage hall belonged to Sri Vairamuthu, the renowned lyricist, and he had christened his wife's name for it. Within the limited space, he had designed it with an artistic finesse. Since it was located at the end of Trustpuram 6th Street, the Kalyana Mantapam was skirted by roads on two sides. Sri Vairamuthu's son's marriage was also to take place at the same time at another venue, and I had been given his mobile phone number for contacting him in case of any necessity, apprising me that somebody may be present in the office room on the marriage day for any help. I had thought then that when everything was all right, why should there be any problem? Unaware then that a dilemma of gargantuan magnitude will be presenting itself before me. On getting a call from the priest, I went to the stage and assured Sri Ramakrishnachar, I shall be here only from this instant. And he in turn said, you should not get down from this platform. The hall was bursting at the seams, and invitees were viewing the proceedings even from the balcony. I was asked whether breakfast serving could be stopped at 9:30 a.m. and the supply of lunch may be started from 10 a.m. I suggested that lunch could be served from 10:30 a.m. Until then, fruit juice could be given to the guests. The crowd was swelling unceasingly, and at about 9:40 a.m., the marriage hall manager, Sri Ravi Kumar, was seen coming towards the stage. I thought he may not be the person as he was to be at the marriage of Sri Vairamuthu's son at that hour. A little later, I realized someone tapping me on my shoulder, and when I turned around, I saw the manager himself there. He requested me to come outside for a moment and started walking fast. I followed him leaving the stage. He stopped at a secluded place. I asked him, what is it, please? I have to tell you something. Please control yourself and try to maintain your mental composure. Sir, please tell what it is. Don't feel unnerved, and after listening to what I tell you, don't exhibit your anxiety outwardly. They will be looking for me on the stage. The way you are talking, it appears you have something shocking to reveal to me. Yes, it is something serious, he said, and revealed the matter to me slowly. On hearing that, I felt like crying aloud, Guru Raja, Guru Raja. My mind instantly became prayerful, chanting Kamakshi Amma, Guru Raja, the whole body trembling then. Don't lose courage. Go to the stage and, excusing yourself with some plausible reason, come to the office room at once, unaccompanied by anyone. If somebody should come with you, avoid such presence in the office room, said the manager with great hesitation, causing in me the feeling of the whole world being topsy-turvy. Guru Raja, what sin have I committed? Why this kind of an ordeal for me? How can I share this with others? I was thinking with fear and grief gripping my heart, at the same time casting a ludicrous smile at those passing by me, extending my welcome to all such persons on my way to the stage. Sri Ramakrishna Acharya signaled to me to be seated on the dais. I could not divulge my anguish even to my wife at that time. When I saw the innocent face of my daughter, the sorrow in me snowballed. What will happen next was outweighing every other thought passing through my mind then, and I was constrained to control myself without exhibiting any change in my countenance. To avoid the manager coming again to the stage, I pretended as if I had to go and receive a VIP, leaving the dais hurriedly. On the way to the office room, I prayed to the Vinayaka outside before entering the room. And there, to my shock, I found two police officials seated in that ambience. They asked my name and I said Satyanathan. They repeated it as Satyanarayana and noted that as my name. They asked my place and I said Triplicane, which also they noted. To their next question, I grieved within myself, praying, Guru Raja, Guru Raja, and wiped out my tears from the upper cloth on me. The marriage hall should be vacated at once. Bring here the bridegroom's father also. I hope you will consent to this and take urgent action, said one of the policemen. Yes, an anonymous telephone call had been received at 9:15 a.m. in Ponmani Maligai. And the person who attended to it was told, between 10 a.m. and 12 noon, bombs concealed at various places in the Kalyana Mandapam will go off, one after the other, the line getting disconnected after that warning message. The manager, not being available then, since he was in attendance at the other marriage function, the staff member who had received the call without getting perturbed and making it public, had passed on the information to the manager over phone. Shocked by the message, the manager had tried to meet Sri Vairamuthu on the stage at the other marriage venue, but the security staff had not permitted his entry in that vicinity as the chief minister, Sri M. Karunanidhi, was present there at that time. The manager then contacted Sri Vairamuthu on his cell phone and broke the news to him discreetly. But instantly there was anxiety writ large on the face of Sri Vairamuthu, which was noticed by the chief minister. And when the CM was appraised about it, a message was at once flashed to the police. And before the manager could come from Guindy to Trasthpuram, the police had made all arrangements to meet any eventuality and were coming towards the Ponmani Maligai. Four sniffer dogs, two firefighting forces and metal detectors carried by 10 police personnel had by then arrived there for timely operations and had been stationed at a spot away from the marriage hall. Only two officials had first entered the office room of the Kalyana Mandapam. They demanded of me my consent to evacuate the marriage hall immediately, saying, there's a message that bombs have been placed here and so we have to make a thorough search of the premises at once in public interest. So shall we announce that everyone should vacate the premises immediately? On hearing those words, I started praying, Guru Raja, Guru Raja, and managed to tell, sir, old people, women and children running helter-skelter and becoming victims of trampling in that pandemonium cannot even be visualized. I then continued praying inwardly, Guru Raja, your advice to Venkanna to think of you and pray to you in distress is not for him alone. It's for everyone. And that way, you must now protect me from this ordeal, Guru Raja. My constant submission to Guru Raja at that hour of predicament was that he should grace the tying of the wedding knot at the auspicious time fixed for it, without any hitch, preventing the evacuation of the marriage hall. The manager was at that time talking to someone hurriedly over the telephone and handed the instrument to the police official in front of him. It was not known to me who was at the other end and what had transpired during the conversation. The cop then told me, time is fast moving out. Two sniffer dogs kept in the neighboring street and our bomb disposal squads with metal detectors have to be brought here now. In the meanwhile, you inform the assemblage at various places in the premises in a positive manner, which, despite the fear overriding me, spurred me to action instantly. I could not make out then whether what I was proposing to do was in order or not. But what was weighing heavily in my mind at that time was the chaos and the stampede and the resultant trampling that could follow if the news about the bomb threat was leaked out and the invitees come to know of it. For a moment, I thought that what I was intending to do was like testing the efficacy of a poison. If for the sake of my daughter's marriage taking place at the auspicious time fixed for it, I should be playing with the lives of more than 1,000 people there. Was it justifiable? And if something should happen to someone, will it not be construed that I had allowed it to happen with a selfish motive? The prasad of Sri Anjaneya, the deity installed by Sri Vijayendra Tirtha, received the previous day, however, gave me the confidence that it would protect me from all troubles. Just as the Lingas had transformed into Anjaneya idols in the episode relating to Sri Vijayendra that we have known about in part 4. I was praying that the bombs should metamorphose into cotton balls. My prayers reinforced then by the confidence that Mangadamman and the Mantralaya Prabhu being ever with me for protection, I need not have to fear any untoward happening. Still, my conscience was telling me that the problem was not one related to me alone. Yes, I had to tell something to the others that should be credible in those circumstances. With such thoughts occupying my mind then, the appearance of two police dogs on the scene created some tremble in me. Many others were also surprised by the presence of those leashed canine beings there. And in a flash, I ran to all places in the Kalyana Mandapam telling everyone, the Mantralaya Peetadhipati and the Mutt officials are to come here today, and so some protective steps are being taken by the police, in consequence of which a thorough check is being conducted by them as a routine exercise. There was a large gathering at the dais set up for the reception, and with metal detectors, the space below that stage was being examined thoroughly. At that moment, I ran to the second floor with a policeman leading a sniffer dog, and from there, when we went to the terrace, the quadruped started circling the water tank, the sight of which caused a reeling sensation in me. "There is nothing here," said the bomb expert. And on hearing those comforting words, I climbed down hurriedly to the dining hall. There, plantain leaves had been laid on the tables and food items were being served to guests, one after the other. The sniffer dog went there also under leash, its master guiding the way. In the meanwhile, some people came there to take me to the dais. "Has Ramakrishnachar called me?" I asked. "Yes, not only Ramakrishnachar, but also the sub-registrar's office people are waiting for you and are calling you," they said, making me scurry to the entrance. "What, sir, it is 15 minutes since we came, but you're still running here and there. Is everything ready? Shall we go inside? I have to go to another place," hastened the sub-registrar. I could not tell him at that time about the bomb threat, lest he should be fleeing from the place instantaneously. "Some VIPs are coming, that's why all this routine check, and people should not get panicky, you see," I told him in a loud tone in such a manner as to apprise the others also of the situation. And when I came to the dais with them, the sub-registrar's assistant handed the papers to be signed by the couple betrothed. Even in the midst of such anguish and insurmountable difficulties, a feeling of exultation sparked in me at that moment. "Guru Raja, the search operation has not concluded yet. At this juncture, at least the marriage registration should be formalized. Please grace its fruition. If things spill out and people start running out of the place, whatever efforts I've taken so far will be rendered futile. Therefore, let at least the formalities pertaining to the marriage registration be completed. Just signing the papers should suffice at this moment, I was mulling. Ramakrishnachar at that time interjected. The ritualistic Mangalya Dharana is not over yet. Please wait for 10 to 15 minutes. The signatures can be taken after that, causing a chillness pass through my spine. The elders on the dais too subscribe to that view, stressing that shastrically that would be the correct way of solemnizing the marriage. On hearing the views of the elders, I started thinking and supplicating. Guru Raja, for the sake of a devotee, you have changed an age-old tradition, about which incident I have written myself. What will happen in the next 10 or 15 minutes is not known to anyone. Therefore, please accept the change in the system of marriage registration and recognize the registered marriage as one solemnized according to the traditional ritualistic norms. With such prayers at heart, I told the priest, the sub-register has to go to other places so we can have the religious part of the ceremonies after the formal registration. I was actually on the horns of a concern, of a dilemma then, not knowing what I should do if the official concern should agree that the registration could be done after the completion of the traditional religious formalities, or should be telling that he would go to another place and come later, and awaiting his response to my proposal with fingers crossed.